Welcome, friends, to this three-day event in Southern California. I'm very happy to be back here again to meet all of you. The reason why I have made this visit is to share with you my experiences with the perfect living master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh, whose disciple I have been for many years and whose teachings have affected my life and affected the lives of so many other people. And I thought it would be nice to share with you what happens when you are able to meet a perfect living master. Before I go further, I must tell you who is a perfect living master. A perfect living master is an ordinary human being like us, totally like us, born like us, lives like us, eats food, and if he's a man, he does shir like us. You know what shir means? Shit, shave, and shower. So he is just like us, and therefore he dies like us. There is no difference. He's a human being who carries karma like us, lives through life like us, and as a human being, he's just like us, no difference at all. Then what is it that distinguishes him from us? What distinguishes him from us is his state of awareness. What does he know? What is he aware of? Not aware of sometime in the past, not aware of something he remembers and can tell us, but awareness that he has when he's talking to us, when he's in our presence. What kind of awareness does he have when he's present here? That makes the difference. He is connected at all times to all regions of creation, all levels of consciousness, and to our true home, where there is only one totality of consciousness. He's continuously aware and experiencing that we are actually all one. And for the sake of experience for the one, he has created the many, so that the experience can be multiplied several times and watched and looked at from different points of view. It would be appropriate to say we are all points of view of one creator. The creator looks at his creation through us from different points of view. Each one of us is a different point of view because we are located differently. We look different. Our bodies are different. Our speech is different. Our culture is different. And yet he is able to make himself the many so that he can watch his creation so closely by being in the creation, in that created form, which we call a human being. He is in all things. He is not absent from anything. He is there in all animals. He is there in all insects, all living forms. He is there in all angels. He is there in all gods. He is there in every piece of brick and stone. He is in everything that you can experience. Because his own nature, his consciousness, not a material thing, it's consciousness, the ability to be conscious, the ability to be aware. And that ability to be aware is in everything. Now this awareness, ability to be aware, can be experienced two ways. One can be an active ability to be aware, like we have. We have the ability to see what is in front of us. I can look at these beautiful flowers. You can see them too. This ability to look at creation is an active ability that you can decide what to look. But then there is a passive ability. This flower has a passive ability to be looked at. It has consciousness of a different kind. It does not activate its own self to have experience. It becomes the experience. And yet it is also creation of consciousness. Consciousness is that which creates by just being conscious of anything it wants to be. It has unlimited power. It can create anything it wants just by becoming conscious of it. When consciousness becomes conscious of something, it creates it and experiences it at the same time. There's no time lag. It's not that once upon a time he created and then he began to experience. The creation and experience are simultaneous. And that is why the creator and the creation are simultaneous and both are immortal. We say the creation is destroyed from time to time. Yes, because he has put the nature of unchangeability, immortality in one end, the Creator. And he has put the mortality, change, dying, finishing on the other end. So at the creation, there is a beginning, a middle, and an end to everything. Nothing has been created which can be perceived or experienced by us which does not have a beginning, middle, and end. And there is no beginning and middle and end where it is being perceived. That's immortal. So this is a great relationship between the Creator and the creation, that the creation can be experienced by the Creator in many eyes, many souls, many experiences, all part of the same experiencer, one. How can one Creator multiply himself into so many? The answer is given to all of us in the form of the ability to dream at night. When you go to sleep at night and have a dream, you can see 20 people there. Are 20 people dreaming or one is dreaming? Looks like they all 20 are the same, including the dreamer. The dreamer does not remember that he has a body lying in a bed sleeping. The dreamer becomes part of the dream. And the self is still the same. The same self that will wake up, the same self is still the self in the dream. But the character that has been created are all part of the dream of this one single dreamer. When he wakes up, all those 20, 30 people disappear. They were all part of him. Similarly, when we see this great creation of so many different types of souls experiencing different types of bodies, when we see these, when we will wake up to a higher level of consciousness, they were all part of you. But there are several levels of waking up. It's not one level. If it was one level, many more people would have woken up by now. But it's not one level. When you wake up from this level to the next one, you discover that there are many more people still there. But they are not all the same that you saw in your dream. It happens in the dream also. Supposing in the dream you see 20 people and you say, these four I know, I can remember them, I recall them. But who are the 16 strangers whom I don't know? And then you wake up and find those 16 never existed, but those four are still there. They are your friends who you meet every day, and they also appeared in your dream. So can you say that those four people are more real than the remaining 16? In the dream, they all looked equally real. But when you woke up, you discovered four were still there, and therefore they were more real because they were also in the wakeful state and also in the dream state. Then you can wake up again from that dream and find only two are left. And then you say, oh, the other two we thought were more real, but they were only more real up to that point. Now only two are left who were in all three levels. Then you finally wake up, you find there's only one left. You say, there was only one friend of mine. He is alive at all levels, and all the others became alive and many only because of those levels of experience. Then you wake up and find even that's gone. You are the only one. You are the real ultimate dreamer. And all these levels of personalities came up at different levels because of your totality of consciousness that creates these. That's the truth. Now, am I giving you a theoretical model which you can examine? No. I am telling you these are verifiable facts which you, any one of you, can verify. How do you verify? By going within yourself to find out if you are the real creative power, if you are awake, can you wake up? Is there an ability in you to wake up? So many mystics have come, so many saints have come and said the kingdom of God is within you. Masters have said the same thing. The kingdom of God is within you. Find it within yourself. Nothing is outside but a reflection of what is inside. It's all being created from inside. Simple statement. Go within. Then why don't we go within? Because we think going within means closing our eyes and creating a darkness in front of us. That's not growing within. That is why somebody says, meditate, close your eyes, you'll go within. And we close our eyes and meditate, and all we are thinking about is all the things which we can't see because we closed our eyes. All our thoughts are on what is all outside. How are we inside at all? Not only that. We are closing our eyes to see with these eyes. When you close these eyes, how can you see? Therefore, when they say that go within, it automatically requires that you don't see with these eyes, you see with some inner eyes. And do we have inner eyes? We all have. We use them all the time. How do we use them? By imagining things. And now sitting here, you can imagine something and a picture comes in front of you. Which eyes are seeing that? Not these eyes. Where does imagination come from? Where do visualization come from? Where can you make a picture even with closed eyes and see it? It comes from an inner eye. So we have an inner eye. In the same way, we have an inner ear. We hear sounds from outside with this ear, but we can hear sound inside. And that's also we do all the time. All of us do it. When we think, we speak. We speak in words, those are thoughts. And we hear the thoughts. So these ears are not hearing thoughts. Which ears are hearing those thoughts? Inner ears. We have inner tactile sense. We have got inner body, inner hands, inner feet. We can walk, fly, move about in the inner self without the use of this body. And we are all doing it without knowing it. Without knowing it, we are doing it. And why don't we pay any attention to that fact is because we take this as real, this physical experience as real. And that's imaginary. That's unreal. This is so solid. It can be verified. The solidity, the reality of this outside experience can be verified. How do we verify? I want to verify, is this chair real? I can touch it. I see something and I verify by touching it. I use the sense perceptions one against the other to verify reality. Now you can do the same thing in a dream. Do you know that? Supposing I was sitting on a chair in a dream, and I said, is it a dream or is it real? Let me touch it. I'll touch the chair. It'll be as real as this. When I wake up, I'll find nothing was real, neither the seeing of it nor the chair. That is why when we try to establish reality by using one sense against the other, sense perception against the other sense perception, we get into a closed circuit and we miss out the reality. We think the current experience is the only reality. And we're constantly examining what is real and we think this is real. Even when we want to find some higher truth, we think this is real, my body is real, and now I'm going to close my eyes in the real body and see some reality. How will reality come? Because you are totally immersed in the thought, in the feeling, in the perception. This is your reality. This body is your reality, and this world is your reality. And within this world, you are trying to find something else. In the pursuit of truth, in the pursuit of higher reality, we are so much handicapped because of this one experience, that we can only experience one reality at one time, not two realities. When we are sitting here in this physical world, this is the only reality we have. We can't see any other reality, not even dream world. You have to go to sleep to see a dream world. You have to awaken to a higher level to see another world, a sensory or astral world. But when we go into dream state, the dream state is our only reality. We forget this physical reality. Then we wake up, this becomes real, that becomes unreal. We go to the higher level of awareness through meditation, that becomes our only reality. This becomes unreal. We come back, this becomes real, that looks like a dream. It's happening all the time. This is because our consciousness is tuned to live in one reality at one time. There are many realities, we know it. The dream, when we are dreaming, is real. It's only when we wake up, we say, oh, that was a dream, not real. That is why the reality that we experience at one time is the only reality at that time. And this is a great handicap to spiritual discovery of the truth. Because even when we want to find the truth, we can't escape from this reality. We don't know how to do it. The problem arises because when we close our eyes, we think we are inside the body. There is recommendation that if you want to really find the truth, go to the third eye center, the center behind the eyes. Good recommendation. Looks easy. When we close our eyes and think we are in the center, what do? We put a little image of ourselves. There I am sitting in front of me. We see ourselves. That's me sitting inside. That's not you at all. That's an image you are making. Then who are you? The one looking at that image. And we don't recognize that. We don't recognize that the seeing power is the one that's you, not the one that you are looking at. You can create any object you like in front of you. Doesn't become you. But there's a mistake we make for years and years in our meditation when we think we are in the third eye center because we can see a little form of ourselves sitting there and we are concentrating on that. And there's another big snag in that kind of procedure is that when you make that little figure in front of you, you think at least that is inside the darkness in your head, not outside. The truth is even that little figure you make is outside of yourself. And I gave a little experiment to verify this. Then you are looking at that little figure. You can draw your hands up like this and take them to your eyes. You know the shape of your body. Your hands know where the eyes are. Even with your closed eyes, you can touch your eyes whenever you like. Don't have to open your eyes to say where my hands are. You know where the eyes are. With closed eyes, you can touch your eyes. Now, when you see that little figure with the closed eyes, bring up your hands like this and go toward the eyes. You'll be shocked that the figure that you're looking at, which you think is inside, passes before you can touch your eyes. It's in front of you. You're imagining something in front of you and using the force of these physical eyes, which are closed, to imagine something which you think the darkness in front of you is inside. The darkness has been created because you close your eyes. And you can't see what is outside, and now you're making an imaginary figure outside. There is no withdrawal of your attention within the third eye center by doing that. If you want to withdraw your attention to the third eye center, you must examine who is looking at that little figure. And where is that? That's way back inside. A lot of practice is needed. And I do encourage people to sit in meditation sessions with experts, with those who can guide you. They will guide you and tell you how to go within and how to experience your own self watching. You are the self. You don't have to imagine a figure. You just know that if you are a unit of consciousness with no dimension and you close your eyes, where are you in this body? You can examine fully. Are you in your hands? Are you in your feet? No. Are you in the heart? People say the heart center is where you belong. Are you in the heart? No. Where are you thinking from about where you are? From the head. It does not take long to find out that the entire contemplation of who you are, where you are, is taking place in the head. Then you bring it up and say, then where am I operating from? Where do I look at? When I open my eyes, I'm looking at something. The two eyes are creating two images. Where do I merge them? How do I see one to create the distance? I merge two stereoscopic images. Where does that happen? They're looking out even now physically. We are always looking out, even with the physical eyes, from the third eye center. Little practice can make you go to the third eye center, and you are able to then know that's where I am supposed to be, as consciousness working in a physical body in the wakeful state. It does not mean you're always there. You're only there when you think the body is real, the world is real, and I'm sitting in that, and where am I operating as a conscious being? Then you are at the third eye center. It's right behind these two eyes in the center, between the ears. It's a very central place. If you see the anatomy of the head and the brain, it's very close to the pineal gland and the pituitary body. It's very close to the center, most protected part of the physical body. But we don't have to now look for where the pineal gland is. We should just look, where are we looking out from? Where are we? This is a very important question to address yourself before you can start any kind of meditation to discover who you are. People miss this point. And they are constantly trying to figure out by closing eyes in the darkness, where am I? Roam around there. They're roaming outside and they think they're inside and make no progress. My master, great master, taught me that you must first establish yourself there, be conscious of it, that you are actually there before you can make any further progress. Do not even use the five holy words. Do not try to listen to sound. Do not try to visualize the master. Do not do any of these steps unless you are for sure you know, you feel that the body is a vehicle, you are in the head, and you are operating from there. Actually, I went to great master. I said, I tried very hard, and I make little images of myself, sometimes expand them, sometimes the space expands, and I see myself flying around. He said, all imaginary things away from yourself. The one who is doing this is you. So I said, how do I place myself? I have a form, and I always imagine I am this form of a human body. I have to place this form. How can I make it small and place it there? He gave me a very good tip which I am giving you now. He said, raise your hand like this and don't look at it. I said, okay, can you imagine you're sitting on top of your finger? And I thought, yeah, I can imagine. I am on top of the finger right now. He said, bring it down slowly. Are you still there? Yes, slowly. Are you still there? Yes, slowly. Bring it here. Jump in. So I jumped in. I could see where I was. I was still the one who was seeing. So little exercises like that, he would give me. And only when you are able to make yourself aware of where you are, meditation should start. Otherwise, you could be spending a lot of time trying to grope inside and find where you are and not make any progress. So that is why I emphasize this, because I know you are all seekers and you are all practicing some kind of yoga or some kind of meditation. So to discover who you are, which is the real thing to discover, who are you really? Because if you can find who you really are, you'll find you are that one. You are that creative power that creates everything. You're not separate from it. You are always part of it. You are always connected. You have never left anything. People talk of the fact that our soul has left its heavenly home. We are lost in this wilderness of this illusion, lost in this wilderness. Now we are searching and we are finding masters to help us find the way back. We are never lost. We are at home. We never left. Then what is this lost business? The lost is we lost awareness of where we are. It's not losing the way, it's losing our awareness. We lost the awareness of totality. We lost the awareness of being a soul, consciousness, by getting an equipment to have more experience in time and space, the equipment called mind. We lost ourselves, identified with the mind, and became part of thinking. I think, therefore I am. We lost that too. And with sense perceptions, we began to think the sense perceptions are our real self. And locked in this physical body, we thought this body is our real self. All these are just internal things working. We lost awareness. And the spiritual journey is not a travel somewhere to find something. It's awakening to higher levels of awareness. From one point of awakening to another, till we find who we really are. But since we move around with the physical body, we can move around with the astral sensory body. Since we can move around with our thoughts and our mind, we think it's a journey. Since we are used to making journeys here, we think this is also a spiritual journey we have to make somewhere. When I was a young disciple, very early on, somebody told me the spiritual path is a beautiful one, where you, like a drop from the ocean, have been separated from the ocean for a long period and are suffering as an individual drop of consciousness. The ocean is totality. Now you have to go travel all the way, stage by stage, from one level to another. The drop is traveling, getting more awareness till it goes and merges in the ocean. That was the concept given to me of the spiritual path. And I pondered, if I am a drop, I'm a beautiful drop. The sun shines through me. I make a rainbow, color in myself. I have an identity. Now they are telling me to follow a spiritual path and go and merge in an ocean. One drop will make no difference to the ocean. I lose everything. I am at least a drop. I'll be nobody. I'm just part of an ocean. And ocean doesn't care if one more drop is added to it or not. I said, this spiritual path is all lose-lose game. No winning at all. For many years I thought like this. I said, what are we doing? Why are we doing this? Well, we merge and become one. Some people, even the pessimists, told me, don't even try, because at least you have some company, some companions here, some friends. There you'll be alone. Why go from companionship and friendship to loneliness again? The creation must have taken place because the creator was lonely. And he said, I want friends, and he came here. Now you want to reverse this and go back to loneliness again? These kinds of thoughts were put into my head. But I discovered that this was not the truth at all. Indeed, the soul is like a drop from the ocean of totality of consciousness. But it never left the ocean. It left the awareness of the ocean. It was still in the ocean. It just became one of the drops of the ocean, aware that there are many other drops, aware that the whole ocean is full of drops, and had more experiences by adding on things like space and time through the mind, sensory system through spreading out the awareness, and using physical bodies and even dream bodies to have more experiences. It had a wonderful opportunity to do all that by awareness, by consciousness, in the totality of that ocean. Never left the ocean. The spiritual journey is to regain our awareness of that. Awareness, step by step, we can gain awareness till we become the ocean, which we always were. It's not that we are going and merging in something. You are realizing your own totality, which is very different. Then you realize you are always that, not that you are now become that. You're not becoming anything, you're realizing who you are. And that's the truth about self-realization. When these mystics say, find out who you are, they are not saying, become a better person. They are saying, find out that you are the entire creative power. And this is all happening in a big show, big creation, which is being generated from consciousness. And at any single time, in any part of this creation, the self is always inside one of the forms of that creation. Always. Not different selves. The same self. Now you can go into a dream and have a different body. A friend of mine who is a woman, a lady, whenever she dreams, she is a man. She looks into the mirror in a dream, she is a man. When she wakes up, she is a woman. But she could say, well, that's not me, that's a man in the dream. She said, no, that's her. She looks at the in the mirror and finds she's a man. The self in the wakeful state has not changed. There was a Chinese philosopher, Fa Hien. He had a dream that he was a butterfly. He was, as a butterfly, he was flying over a garden with full of flowers. And as he went from flower to flower, he said, they are so beautiful. There were light radiating, colors radiating out of those flowers. He had never seen those. He said, this is reality. This is reality. I am a really butterfly. And he woke up. When he woke up, he really thought, that was more real. Am I really a butterfly who is having an experience? I am a philosopher. Or I am a philosopher who had experience, he was a butterfly. Which is true? He told his friends, I had a very strange dream in which I saw I was a butterfly. And the friend said, don't be stupid. You are not a butterfly. You are a human being. You are a philosopher. Say you saw a butterfly. He said, I never saw a butterfly. I was flying. I was seeing things. I saw the flowers. But my body was a butterfly. The point he was making was that the self of the wakeful state, the physical body of a philosopher, was still the same self in the butterfly. You can take any form you like. You can be formless. You still have the same self. You can have a strange kind of form. You can be the whole universe. You still have the same self. No matter what form you take in any level of consciousness, the self remains the same. If you study carefully, everything we experience, the whole of creation, is changeable, changes. Nothing remains the same, except the self. That is, it's watching the experience, that's experiencing that, remains the same. If the definition of true reality was that which never changes, then the self is the only thing that never changes. Everything else changes. So when you say self-realization, know thyself, they are talking of that self, that creative power of consciousness which is within you. This is just a first step how to do meditation by first placing yourself there. What will happen? If you stay there long enough, what will happen? People sometimes want to sit in meditation. They close their eyes in a solitary place where there is no disturbance. They get relaxed. They feel peaceful. Not always. Most of the time when they sit relaxed, their mind is running around remembering the old problems. Mind is running around to look for things that they lost. The mind is running around with what so-and-so did to them, how they were hurt by those people, how they were disappointed in so many ways. That's what the mind is doing when you are peaceful and relaxed. You think you are very peaceful and relaxed, your body is relaxed. You are in different mudras and different asanas, different positions of the body, saying you are relaxed. Mind is not relaxed. I have not seen a single person who can say that he got the shavasana, he died and put up that kind of most relaxing position and his mind was relaxed. The mind never relaxes. The mind keeps on thinking, no matter what. You can't relax the mind like this, nor can you stop it from bothering you with thoughts. Thinking is an essential part of the mind's life. Our mind that thinks must think all the time in order to survive. On the other hand, this body can survive till the mind is alive. The body can survive. The mind dies, body dies with it. Everything else dies with it. So the mind is the circulation of breathing and blood in the body. The heartbeat in the body sustains us. Heart stops, breathing stops, we say is dead. If the mind stops thinking, it's dead. So therefore the mind never stops thinking. It thinks all the time. And what does it think? What is the thinking of the mind? What kind of thoughts does the mind have? Mostly it thinks of negative things, unfortunately. But the pleasant things it forgets. Supposing 100 good things have happened and one bad thing happens after that, it will dwell on the bad thing, forgetting the 100 things. People thank God for the good thing that happened to them. Thank you, God, I found good fortune today. Thank God, I was coming and there was no parking place, but I found a parking place. Thank you gave me a parking spot. Even for these little things, they're thankful to the Lord. But if one bad thing happens, all these are forgotten. The mind dwells on negative things more than on positive things. And we continue to listen to the mind and become negative with the mind. If the mind is thinking negative things, we don't distinguish ourselves, separate ourselves, that we are not part of the mind. Mind is a separate machine working. We think we are the mind. This relationship of our own self, the consciousness and mind, is so tight that we can't find out, is it me thinking or am I empowering the mind to think? That's a very important part of self-realization. Are you able to distinguish yourself, discriminate and separate yourself from the mind? If you think you are the mind, you'll be trapped all the time, no matter what. No matter how hard you try to meditate. If you are the mind is thinking negatively, where will you get out of it from? How hard will you try? People say, we try to subdue the mind by using mantra, by using holy words to repeat. Yes, they do serve some purpose. While you're repeating the holy words, you are trying not to let the mind think anything else except those holy words. But have you ever noticed when you are speaking the holy words, the mind is still saying, no, no, you are speaking to doubt. No. The mind becomes a commentator on those holy words and then takes you out again into other problems. If you say, okay, I'll subdue the second mind also, like the second channel of the mind, it jumps into the third channel. You go to that fourth channel. It has got so many layers. Finer and finer sounds of the mind can be heard. You test it out. That wherever you are thinking, our thoughts start from our tongue. We want to think something, our tongue starts moving with it. Especially when we want to put a thought into our mind. If you allow the mind to think by itself, it never uses the tongue. But when you say, let me repeat a mantra with the mind, the tongue moves with it because we are trying to speak it out. And while the tongue is moving and we are thinking, we are doing the mantra, the mind is thinking of everything else. There is no real peace when the mind is still working as a negative entity right inside us. To be able to separate the mind and say, I am not bothered with this thinking machine. To be able to feel that you are not bothered, ignore it. Then one of the important teachings I emphasize on is how to ignore your mind. Nobody can stop it. There was I have repeated the story many times, but I tell you again, there was a colleague of mine at Harvard University who used to practice deep meditation of different types. He had practiced with many yogas and yogis and so on. He called me one day. He said he has learned to sit into a certain asana, certain position of the body, and then hold his breathing first and then the mind. So then from the breathing, he is able to control the mind and he can stop the mind. I was very astonished. I said, are you sure about it? He said, absolutely, I can. I said, how long can you stop the mind from thinking? He says, maybe, but I've learned enough to hold it for half an hour. I said, will you come to my place and let's see how you do it? I might learn something totally new. So I invited him to my apartment and I said, put on your asana and your breathing or whatever you want to do so that you are ready. And I'll test out what happens when the mind is not thinking. I'm just interested in that. What happens to consciousness in a living body if the mind is not even thinking? So I said, when you are ready, I will give you a signal by clapping my hand. And I'll keep my eye on the watch. After 60 seconds, 1 minute, I'll clap again, you can start thinking. If you can do it for 1 minute, I'll believe you can do it forever. Stopping the mind for 1 minute should enable you to stop forever if you want to. He said, yes, he got into that asana and he prepared himself when he was ready. I clapped and looked at my watch. After 60 seconds, I clapped again. I said, did you stop thinking? He said, yes. I said, let's examine what was in your consciousness, in your awareness, when you were not thinking. I said, first question is that when I clapped, how did you know this is the time to stop thinking? Now I'm saying, don't make a guesswork. Just remember, personal memory. It just happened a few minutes ago. Remember what happened. And he said, I can remember when I heard the clap, I said, this is the time to stop thinking. I said, that's a thought. He said, no, but that only took a few seconds. I said, all right, let's cut out 3 seconds of the 60 seconds. Now we'll see what happened in the 57 seconds. After when you said that this is the time to stop thinking, how did you know that when I clap again, you can start thinking again? Remember what actually happened in your head. And he remembered, yes, I did say after that, and when he claps again, I can start thinking again. So that's another thought. To cut the long story short, in a few minutes, we were able to find that he was continuously thinking about the clapping, that when it'll come. And then at the end of our discussion, he put up his hand like this. He said, I never knew I thought more in this 60 seconds than ever before. We can't stop thinking. It's the lifeline of the mind, which is an essential part of what we are as conscious beings. That is why we cannot stop thinking, but we can ignore what the mind is doing. And that's the real technique. If the mind is negative, you can ignore its negativity. You can instill something in the mind so that it keeps away from you. Somebody said, how can you do that? I said, very simple. I'll give you a physical exercise. When the mind says, I want chocolate today, say no. Here's just a little chocolate. Say no. Only today, no. If you can keep on saying no 2 or 3 times a week, you'll be able to ignore the mind. When the mind wants to do certain things and you are able to stop it and ignore it, the mind changes its own character. And instead of being negative, tries to follow that, okay, this guy, this self is not listening to me. Now remember, the nature of the soul, the nature of our own self, separated from body, perceptions of the senses, or mind, or thinking, is a listener by nature. It's a listener. We are born listeners. We listen. Our whole experience of creation is through listening. Because the mind speaks, and we listen. If the mind did not speak, we had nothing to listen to. We back home. The mind is speaking continuously, and we are listening to it continuously. Now I'm going to say something which needs some examination by you thoroughly. I look at these flowers. It's a sense perception. I see red color, and I see certain form. My eyes see that and put it there. How do I know they are roses, they are flowers? Perception does not show their flowers. Perception does not show their roses. Perception shows red color and their form. How do I know they are roses? If you carefully look at how you know they are roses, the mind speaks. When the perception brings this information, the mind says, these are roses, and you listen and they become roses. If the mind does not speak all our sensory experiences of all 5 senses, we never have them. Therefore, even the whole world we are experiencing at this time is because of the power of consciousness to listen. And listening is the greatest capacity. Now, I'll talk to you further later on, maybe tomorrow, the importance of listening as a means of discovering who's listening. If it is the power of the soul, your consciousness that can listen, and we have got an extra attachment called the mind to speak, the power of consciousness enlivens, empowers the mind to speak, and then it listens. We are able to have communication with people with using the mind, with the power of speaking, with the power of communication, and we listen. This distinction that the mind speaks and we listen, the soul listens, the very sharp distinction between the two. And as you progress in your spiritual growth and your meditation, you will see clearly that you are the listener alone. The capacity to listen is built into your soul, into consciousness. And we are using other means to enable us to have those experiences by listening. And mind is a very important part in that. That makes us see all things by listening to what it is saying. It interprets everything for us. Without interpretation of the mind, of sense perceptions, they'll make no sense at all. So this interpretation is done by talking by the mind and listening by the soul. Listening is important because since it is the nature of the soul to listen, it can listen to itself. Wouldn't that be a great shortcut to discovery of oneself? It is indeed a shortcut. The latest yoga which I have practiced and successfully, which you can all practice successfully, is called the Surta Shabda Yoga. What does that mean? Surta is attention, your soul putting attention. To what? To Shabda, sound. And listen, and yoga means union with your own higher self. Surta Shabda Yoga, the power of listening to your own self in discovering, is the shortest way. There's no better way. I've tried several ways in my own life, and I found that the capacity of the self to listen, and it has its own resonance which it can listen to. It doesn't have to listen to outside things at all. It can listen to itself. And the self, the creative power, is not a sound. It's a creative power. It includes everything in it. It's the ocean. But when the ocean comes down through experience to different levels and becomes the form of a human being, alive, kicking with consciousness, then that consciousness generates a sound of its own, which can be heard. And that's called the shabd. That's called the sound to be heard in order to discover who you are. This is a great thing. To be able to listen to your own sound. It looks like a sound when we are here. That's good enough. So long as we can verify as we go along that it's the same sound that's coming from the origin, from our totality, uninterrupted. All other experiences get interrupted. When we go to sleep, the dream state is an interruption of the wakeful state. We don't smoothly go from one to the other. We shut off one by sleeping and create the other. When we go to the higher level of consciousness at the astral plane, we shut off these and open up that. When we go to still higher level, we shut off that. Each is a complete shut off of one level of experience to open up another. But the resonance of the self never changes. It continues through every level and can be heard at this level, can be experienced at a higher level, and becomes our own self at the highest level. At least we know there's one thing that is common and is continuously running between all levels of consciousness and all levels of creation. And that looks like a sound. That is why they have called it by different words. Different culture, different religions, different mystic practices, they all refer to that as a sound. Because in the human body, in the physical world, it can be heard like a sound inside. It is not like the sound outside. It's a resonance resonating in your own self. It's like a surround sound around you. And when you catch that, you get closer and closer to your own self without trying other hard methods of meditation. Hard methods of twisting and turning your body, hard methods of repeating words is the fastest way. So I'll talk to you more about that, the path of listening to the sound and discovering the reality, which is a shortcut, but sometimes we have to go by a long route to go to the shortcut. Why? A mind likes that. Can you imagine the mind thinks a simple thing is too easy, could not be real. Complicated things, make it as complicated as possible, loves it. And if you can classify it, if you can put numbers on it, there are 10 steps to it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, oh, mind loves, that must be right. People say there are 5 levels of creation, 6 levels of creation, placed one on the other. This is the physical. We fly up, go to the astral. We fly higher up, go to causal, fly still higher, and go to spiritual, go to a true home somewhere up there. That's not the truth at all. We don't go anywhere outside. We don't go higher up at all. We go within. The more we go toward the self that is operating as a conscious awareness in us, the closer we are to the self. But mind doesn't like that part. If you say, go within, 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 you get there. Mind says, what kind of nonsense is this? But no, there are all levels of consciousness placed one on top of the other. Mind says, that looks like truth. So this kind of a classification, the nature of the mind is to divide. It was purposely put like that. So we could be the many, divided, separated, to have this experience of separation. The mind is doing a good job of its mandate to separate. Every time we want to look at a problem, we want to look at something, the mind divides. Its method is analysis, analytical, to break into pieces and see what is. Little child wants to see a toy. Before playing with it, he wants to break and see how it's operating. The mind is still the same, from childhood till the death, time of death. We are constantly trying to analyze things, break them into pieces to see what it is. And every time we break it, we lose sight of the whole. And that's why we don't see reality. Reality is seen when you see the whole. Soul without mind can see reality. because its process is exact opposite of the mind. Synthesis, see totality, see the whole picture, the grand picture. Here's a picture of my master here, Baba Sawan Singh. Supposing I were to take this picture and I want to examine it carefully, I take a piece of scissors, a pair of scissors, and cut it into small pieces and heap them upon this table. Say, I have got my master's picture on this table. And I look at each piece one by one, one by one. Where is the master? I can see all of them and never see the master. You put this painting together, I can see the master. When I'm seeing at the picture, I'm not seeing at each piece either. I am seeing the whole picture. If you see the whole picture, it's perfect. You cut into pieces, it's nothing. The mind cuts our experience into pieces. It uses the scissors of days and nights and here and there. These are the scissors that is cutting the whole experience. The experience of now and then, the experience of here and there, the experience of time and space. A complete concoction, complete method of the mind. Soul doesn't need any of that. Soul looks at the grand picture, the whole creation at one go. And the mind says, no, first look here, then look there, then we lose the picture. So that's what's happening. So this ability to be able to perceive the creation and the creator from the vantage point of the soul, which can see the whole picture, gives you a knowledge of reality. All others give you pieces which are imperfect. As you see the whole, it's perfect. We'll talk more about it. I'd like to take a break and answer some questions for you if you have any. Who is there? George? Dr. George Aiken. He will read out the questions.
In one of the satsangs, Master, you mentioned that Satchkhand is an illusion. So does that mean aspiring to go to Satchkhand and merge into totality is also an illusion?
In one of the satsangs, you mentioned that Satchkhand is an illusion. So does that mean aspiring to go to Satchkhand and merge into totality is also illusion? Yes, it is. All creation is illusion, no matter what, even Satchkhand. Everything created, but it does not experience as illusion. None of this illusion experiences as illusion, experiences as reality. There was a famous dancer in India, and she was interested in spiritual truths. She read all the scriptures of Indian scriptures, and she read again and again a description of this world as Maya, Mithya, that means illusion, destructible illusion, that will not last. And she constantly thought, how come I look at things and I don't see them as illusion? And the books say they're all illusion. This world is illusion. I happen to be one day invited to witness her dance performance. And after that, she said, I want to ask some questions. And she had a cup of tea with me afterwards. And she said, I have only one question. Is this world illusion or is it real? I said, it's not illusion. So we were having a cup of tea and I held this cup. I said, is this cup real or illusion? She said, look pretty real. But the book says it's an illusion. I said, now take a sip of it. Did the tea taste illusion or real? The taste was real. I said, now I'm going to propose to you what is illusion, what is real. The cup, the seeing of the cup was real. The tasting of the tea was real, but the cup and the tea were not real. Can you understand it? She said, how can that be? I could only taste the tea because the tea was in the cup. I said, that's what you think, that's what you feel, that's what you experience. That's why illusion has become reality. But the truth is, your ability to see the teacup was the creation of the teacup. Your ability of the tongue to taste the tea was the creation of the tea. But it looked like they were giving you the tea and the cup was actually there, therefore you were seeing it. It is not the things themselves can be illusion, but not the experience of them. Experience is always real. He's having an experience. How can you say it's not happening? He's having an experience. It's real. No matter whether the object is created by illusion or created by reality, your experience will always be real. Let's go back to the dream state. In the dream, let's say you have a cup again, and tea is there, and somebody's talking to you. Is this cup real or not real? I can see it's real. Now taste it. Okay, taste it. The taste of tea is good. So is the tea and the cup real? Yeah. Then you wake up. Neither the cup was there nor the tea. The taste of the tea was still there, even when you wake up. The experience was real. The things were not real. The same thing is true here. Same thing is true at all created reality. It's not that illusion is what we are seeing. We are seeing reality created by the process of illusion. And we call it illusions because consciousness has created by just being conscious of it. That's it. Experiencing it. The mind won't easily accept this, that experience creates reality. But today, even physicians and the scientists are beginning to say, the last article I read of physics professors is observation is creating reality. Because they're seeing that an observation can change the things. It started off when the quantum physics were first born by observing that the light waves moving through them become waves, but if you look at them and put them to a measurement, they become particles, photons. Are they waves or are they photons particles? They've been debating ever since. They're still debating. But now they have seen that even other things, like an electron, they couldn't observe these things earlier, but now microscopes exist. That an electron moving on a hydrogen atom is only one electron. It's moving around its nucleus. In which orbit is it moving? We know how far it is from the nucleus. But is it moving like this? Is it moving like that? Which orbit is it moving? There are millions of orbits possible. It could be anywhere. You touch with a laser pointer, anywhere at that point, the electron is there. But if you put it once, it's always there, nowhere else. Before that, it was always everywhere. When you touched it, it was there only. How can human observation make it static and make it only one place? So this is an observation going on now in physics, in science, that what you observe is what is creating reality for you. It's altering electrons and atoms. If you can alter atoms and electrons, which are the building blocks of this universe that we see from external empirical evidence, then obviously the power of observation is doing something else. The truth is, which you can examine if you go to the truth within, that it's entirely your consciousness that becomes conscious of the reality which you're creating, including Sachkhand, the true home. The only difference is that Sachkhand lies beyond the mind, and therefore beyond time and space, and therefore it's eternal, forever. Therefore you are immortal there. You're immortal because there's no change. It's forever there. But that does not make it not part of creation. And creation is experience, experiential creation. The created universe, the created reality, is always a creation through what we might call the great power of using illusion by consciousness to create reality. The power is not being used to create shadows. The power is being used to create reality at all levels, including the highest.
When a person dies, do they remain in the presence of loved ones to assist with grieving? If so, how long do they stay?
When a person dies, do they remain in the presence of loved ones to assist with grieving? If so, how long do they stay? When a person dies, he dies in the physical body, which means he does not die. The physical body dies. He still survives in a disembodied state. In that disembodied state, he can see his body because the body is finished. There's nothing in it. He's been separated. But he's still in a form similar to the body, which we call the astral suksham sharir, or which means the subtle body or the astral body or sensory system. The sensory systems remain intact. That means the power to see, hear, touch, taste, smell, they're all intact, even after death. And these senses are what constitutes that body. There's no matter in it. There's no physical matter in an astral body. It's completely made up of sense perceptions. So those sense perceptions still work and placed in the same form as the physical body in which, from which they have come out. And therefore, they look like they are disembodied forms of human beings. They stay there to see what's going on. Some of them get laugh at what's happening. They laugh because before dying, before a person dies, the whole life picture reverse, what they were doing yesterday, before that, right to the birth, comes back to their, like a flash, very quick flash before them, then they die. After death, they are seeing people grieving and they try to console them. They no need to grieve. I am not dead. But the people still keep on grieving. Can't you hear me? I am not dead, I am more alive. I can see better. I don't use glasses here. My vision is 20/20 already. I've thrown away my glasses with the body. We are grieving, man is gone. So what kind of assistance can they give us when we are grieving? They don't care for grieving. They say, we are okay. Don't you see we are okay? You think we are dead? That's how they shout, but we can't hear them. We can't see them. And so we just believe maybe they are around us to help us in grieving. That's not the right way. My suggestion is that when a person dies, wish him farewell. Wish him, go on your journey. You were trying to make progress, especially if that person is on a spiritual path. Don't hinder him from going. Don't make him wait there to say he's not dead, he's not dead. Say, I know you are in spirit form. Go your way. We wish you luck. Wish you have great time ahead. And the man will happily go and say, bye-bye, I'm so happy that you understand what's going on. At least if we have this knowledge that death is not a death of consciousness, death of this physical body. That the astral body, the mind, the soul, they all survive. They all move around. Now, there can be cases where there's an unnatural death, like suicide, murder, accident. Now, those are supposed to be also predestined. They happen at the right time. But the system doesn't work like that. The karmic system, which is dividing all these events, one after the other, doesn't work like that. The karmic system wants to show that was unnatural. That was an interruption of life. And because of that, the arrangement is that when you die, you still stay on. Don't go anywhere else. You stay either hovering around, looking for something that you couldn't find, or you become stationary at the place where you died because that's what's occupying your consciousness, that you died here. You're murdered here. You can see your murderer. You can see who killed you. You want to take revenge, but you can't go anywhere. In India, we call these disembodied spirits by two names, Bhoot and Preth. Bhoot is a ghost-like disembodied figure. They're running around all over. It's searching for something, doesn't know, travels the whole globe. It can fly so fast. That body has no restriction, so it can fly fast. It goes all over, searching for something, searching for that you couldn't meet, searching for something that was lost. And the other is Pret, who is stuck at one place, because that's where the suicide was committed, that's where something happened, that's where the event causing death took place. How long will he be there? So long as his notional life was there, which was interrupted. So each one of us have a notional life and an actual life. The notional life, if interrupted, supposing a person was supposed to live, if that interruption had not taken place, to 80 years of life, at 40, he commits suicide. For 40 years, he'll be around there in that ghost form or in the spirit form or disembodied form in that state. Will not be able to escape because he's still fulfilling the karma, paying off the karma. He can't create any more, but he's still paying off the karma for the remaining 40 years. This law of karma is a very subtle one. I think I'll sometimes explain it to you, how subtle it is and how it works on us. And that, because of this law of karma, he'll be stuck there for 40 years. So far as grieving, the person can't assist you in grieving. He's trying to say things, something very different from what you are expecting. So if you want my tip on this, what to do when somebody dies, say farewell, I know you have left your body, you're going ahead, we pray you go higher and higher in your awareness, in your journey.
Are violent video games karma? Some games are violent, such as GTA on PlayStation, where there is killing. By playing those games, do you create karma?
Are violent video games karma? Some games are violent, such as GTA on PlayStation, where there is killing. By playing those games, do you create karma? I was going to postpone this issue of karma, but I have to talk now because of this question. There is three kinds of karma. Karma we are born with, which we call destiny, fate. We are born at a particular place. We die at a particular place. There are events already placed where we will fall sick, where we'll accident, where we'll meet people, where we will fall in love with people, where we'll marry, where we'll have children, where we'll do this, and then we die. These events are already placed in our life on a timeline called a lifetime. This is called pralabdh. We call it pralabdh or predestined fate with which we are born. These events are bound to happen at those times. In fact, they've already happened. They first happen, then we go over this. We do time travel. We are all doing time travel. They said Egyptians did it. We are doing it right now. We are moving from one event to another. That's time travel. Except that we believe in the little watches and clocks that we have. Oh, 1 hour has passed. We don't know if 1 hour has passed or not. When you do meditation and you think 1 hour has passed, it's only 10 minutes. And when you are having coffee with a friend in a restaurant, you say, we have to sit only for 10 minutes. An hour passes. Oh, an hour, not 10 minutes. So time is so subjective in its experience. But we go by the clocks, not by our experience. I was wrong in my experience. I believe the clock. That's how we are living. The clock determines this time sequence, and the events are placed on that which we call our destiny. In between these events, and there's a lot of time in between these events, the mind which makes choices between alternatives presented before it is given choices. You can go right or left. You can eat, not eat. You can meet, not meet. You can talk, not talk. You have all these options coming up in the gaps that exist. And that is where you use what is called free will. Free will means the ability to choose between different alternatives that are in front of you. You can choose A, B, or C. You said, oh, let me think, which is better, A, B, or C? A is better, A. This ability to deliberate upon alternatives and pick up one, that's called free will. If there's only one choice, that's not free will. If only A is offered, you have to take A. That's pralabdh, destiny. But when there's A, B, C, and you pick up, that's new karma being created. We call that karman karma, distinguished from pralabdh. Karman is new karma being created by us, by our free will. We do that all the time. It does not require action. It requires intention to act. When you intend to act, karma is already there. And we intend to act so many things. We create a bundle of karma all the time. We create so much karma in one lifetime, there's no way it can be paid off in 1, 2, or 10 lives. We create so much karma. So therefore, the karma is every time we are thinking this or that. And these choices are coming in front of us all the time. That's how the system works, that we are choosing different choices that come up, and every time we make a choice, it's karma is created, whether good or bad. Now, what makes good karma and bad karma is what you define as good or bad. in your own head. You feel, oh, I've done a good deed. I've been rewarded. You are rewarded. It's a good deed. You say, that was horrible. I feel guilty. You're punished. Karma works on a system of morality generated in your earliest thinking. Earliest activity of the mind generates these thoughts. Sometimes they're even earlier than your birth. That's from past lives. But you do have thinking based upon some moral values. Most of them develop through the society in which you live. Depends on which society you live, the values are different. Countries you live, religion you follow, they're all different. But the karmic pattern is based upon what your mind is determining, good, bad, or neutral. And the reaction is accordingly figured out. Okay, you did bad, you'll be punished. You may do something which you think bad, or society thinks bad, which has made you think it is bad. You may be punished the same life, outside. You murder, you are hanged, it's finished. That karma is finished. You're punished here. Where you are not caught, which is very often, when you are not caught, then the punishment is reserved for a later time. This is how the karma is being created, and we are then accumulating it. When we die, this whole flashback that comes to us before death, immediately we can see what was good, what was bad. We are determining our next life before we are dying here. When we die, the package of karma that becomes the problem, the fate of the next life by reborn in the next form. It could be human form or any form. We are creating all that. Then the package is made. Supposing you have a lot of karma, all cannot fit in. So some is fixed up for your next life. The rest flows into a reservoir. And that reservoir we call the sinchit karma, the karma of reservoir of different things. Reservoir keeps on growing big, depending on how many lifetimes we have been here. Ultimately, so huge, it can generate hundreds of lifetimes, even if we have no karma. Supposing somebody says, I want to live in the will of God, I want to go with the flow, like they used to say. I just follow what comes, not make any choices. I let other people make choices. I let circumstances make choices. I am going with the flow. I live in the will of the Lord. And he doesn't make any decision. He just goes on what is happening. So he's creating no new karma. But there's plenty in the reservoir to make a life for him. Sometimes the reservoir can be used where we find that some items can be accommodated in a future life, some others cannot. Pull out something from the 101st life. In one of our stories in Mahabharata, one of the epic stories, there Lord Krishna is supposed to be avatar of Vishnu, God, and he has knowledge of all these things. The king, a blind king, asks him, he says, Krishna, you taught me how to look at past lives. I have looked at 100 of my past lives. I did nothing in those 100 lives to be blind. How come I have become blind? He said, look further back. 106th life, you took out the eyes of a person. And that's why you're blind. It took 106 lifetimes before that particular event was placed into a human life. So this is a very, very strange trap. The biggest trap is the trap of the mind creating karma and the karma becoming a method of continuously moving. Do good, you come and be rewarded. Do bad, get punished. Do good, be rewarded. Be very good, be rewarded more. But you still remain here. No escape from it. It's a very well-designed trap that you can never get out of here. So this is, the sinchit karma operates like that. When we play games, a lot of games are violent games, and we think of violence because of those games, we create karma. If we don't play games but still think of violence, we still create karma. If we are actually violent, we create karma. So violence in any form creates a karma which we believe is not good for us. We have been taught that violence is not good. Yet we are all violent in some way or the other. This is another distinction of a human mind, that human mind divides things into good and bad. And it somehow feels that the bad are more delicious, more pleasurable, and therefore does a lot of bad things, knowing they are bad, and therefore fixing the future karma just by doing that. So, and we say we can't help it. There are some things that we don't want to do. We resolve never again. And next time we're again doing it. Have any of you ever had an experience when you said, I won't do this ever again, and then did it again? How many? So common. This thing is so common. In fact, I'll tell you a little story. It's a little joke, but it's a good story to illustrate this point. There were two elk hunters. Elks are those deer-type animals which live in the mountains in the snow. Two elk hunters went to do elk hunting, and they hired a small plane, and they landed up in the slopes of that mountain, and they killed four elks. They dragged the elks to the plane, and the pilot said, look, these elks are very heavy. You can't put four in the plane, take two at a time. They said, no, last year we took four, and it's the same size of plane. Why won't we take it now? In spite of the resistance of the pilot, they loaded all the four elks. The plane crashed. In the crashed plane, the elks were already dead. The pilot died, but these two survived somehow. From the debris, they come out. And one says to the other, where are we? The other says, same place like last year. That's all right.
I understand that we have to refrain from drugs and alcohol. What about drugs like Tylenol for curing common colds? Is that okay? What about marijuana? And if you have been prescribed marijuana for eating disorders, what is your take on that?
I understand that we have to refrain from drugs and alcohol. What about drugs like Tylenol for caring for common cold? Is that okay? What about marijuana if you are prescribed for eating disorders? What is your take on that? My take is very clear. Why do we avoid drugs and alcohol? What's the purpose of avoiding them? They're good, some people enjoy them. Why can't they continue to have alcohol and drugs while they are practicing spiritual yoga, practicing spiritual exercises? The reason is that in order to discover yourself, within yourself, the tools we have are our attention, our power of imagination, and the awareness that we can concentrate our attention on anything we like. These are three things. The power to imagine, the power to use attention, the power to concentrate our attention on whatever we like. These are the three means which we use for meditation. When we want to place ourselves at the third eye center, put our attention there, our whole attention there, which means concentrating our attention there, the power of concentration is being used. Drugs and alcohol remove that power. They take away that power. You can't concentrate. People also ask me, why are you a vegetarian? What has diet to do with meditation? Same thing. When you take food of any kind, you are extinguishing life or taking something where life has been extinguished for your eating. Today, in this world in which we are created here, life subsists on life. Look at all living things. They're all living off on other living things. Even vegetables. Vegetarian food is also living. They're also having the life, having souls like ours. All living forms have the same type of soul. So then when we eat vegetables, we are also eating something where life was extinguished. Then what's the difference? The difference is that the degree of awareness, of consciousness in the different species is different. They used to, in India, count how many tattvas, how many elements are there. The vegetables have basically one element, water, then other have two elements, three elements, four elements. Ultimately, human beings have all five elements, including the element of making distinction and having free will and discrimination. So when you add up these, those which the lowest form, extinguish that, affects your power of concentration the least. The higher you move up, the more it affects your power of concentration. This is not a theoretical thing. You can practice it. You can try it yourself. If you pluck an apple, you have not destroyed the tree, but you still hurt it to some extent by taking away fruit. It's meant for you, you will say. But your power of concentration is slightly affected, which you may not notice. The recovery period is very short. You recover your power of concentration very quickly. You kill an animal, kill a dog, kill a cow, kill a big animal, and try to concentrate, your thought will be on that killing. How do you test your power of concentration? Read a book. You all read books. See how long it takes for you to read a page from that book. You were reading it 1 minute a page, now it's 2 minutes, now it's 3 minutes. You're concentrating, trying to read the same thing, and that is affecting you. If you murder a man and come and read, you may not be able to read for days. This is a proven fact that the degree of life, degree of consciousness, awareness of that life that you extinguish to make it food, that affects your power of concentration. So what you should eat, the importance of diet, is only important for those who are serious about serious meditation. For those who are interested in achieving something while they are still here, not wait for afterlife to see what happens, for them it's easily possible to lose your concentration of attention by drugs, alcohol, or even meats. One can say, well, we didn't kill. One of the people who told me, I didn't kill, so the karma will go to the guy who killed. One of the men was Dalai Lama, His Holiness Dalai Lama of Tibet. When he came to India, I was the district commissioner of the district where he had to be placed, which included Dharamsala, the city where he's now living. So I, being there, it was my duty to go and receive him and to bring him and house him there. During that period, I became a great friend of his. So I had a Land Rover and we used to go out for outings and compare notes. He had two tutors with him at that time who were also non-vegetarian. He was non-vegetarian. He took all kinds of meats. They took it in Tibet. So he would argue on this thing with me that, what is it that prevents us from concentrating? If it is karma of killing, I didn't kill. Some other guy killed, I ate what he killed. Karma is his, I just enjoyed the food. And I said, no, the effect on concentration is not a conscious effect at all. You're not conscious of it, it's subconscious. The subconscious carries that this was supposed to be from killing of an animal. This is what I am eating, this subconscious is speaking. So many of your decisions are based upon what the subconscious is pushing from below. The subconscious pushes you and prevents the concentration. We had argument for a few days. I said, I'll give you a better method than argument. Try it. Try for 1 month to be a vegetarian. And he became. And he said, I have become a vegetarian forever. And he became a vegetarian till much later than for medical reasons. It's uric. They had to feed him something. And he came back and told me, they broke my vegetarianism. I said, it doesn't matter. You achieved what you wanted to achieve. Moreover, you are not only a spiritual leader, you are a temporal leader. You are leading a country. And therefore, your turn for more spiritual activity can come later. Don't worry. When you leave this temporal work, it will come. Only last year he left the temporal work, gave it to others. Now back on spiritual thing. Why I'm bringing it this to you, there's nothing like practice. If you don't think it's useful, try it. If it's not useful, throw it away. But drugs and alcohol certainly lower your capacity to concentrate your attention. So serious meditation is affected by that. Tylenol is all right. Marijuana for medical reasons is all right. Doctors prescribe things. I was practicing homeopathic medicine myself. It's made out of alcohol. Great master visited my clinic. And I said, Master, you said don't take alcohol. I'm not only taking, I'm serving to others. He said, you serve alcohol or do you serve remedies, medicines? And I serve remedies. Why are you talking of alcohol? I said, it's preserved with alcohol. He says, that's all right. You're not getting drunk with that. You're getting healed with that. So for medical reasons, it's fine. If medically you are advised by a doctor to take something, take it. Because it's necessary for you to be healthy. You can't meditate if you're not healthy. If you say, I'm avoiding that, but I'm unhealthy, and I'm going to meditate, you won't. It's not only what food you eat or what drugs you take that makes your quality of meditation better. There are several other things. What other things disturb you? So remember, medical advice, yes, go ahead. Okay?
Please describe the experiences after one successfully connects to or is pulled by Shabad or the sound current.
Please describe the experiences after one successfully connects to or is pulled by Shabad. When one is pulled by the Shabad in meditation, the Shabad sounds like the resonance of a bell. You hear a bell, this church bell ring, dong, dong, dong. When I say dong, it's because the bell is being hit. Therefore, that dong is there. What about without that? Without the dong. That kind of sound is the initial sound that you can identify with your own self. When that sound comes, because there are many other sounds that start coming in when you are trying to be pulled by Shabad, but it doesn't pull you. Because the real sound is not being heard. When you try to meditate, put your attention inside, there's so many sounds of your heartbeat, of your breathing, they can be heard. There was a Japanese mystic. I met him at an international conference, and he said he's designed a soundproof meditation chamber. So nothing can distract him, no sound from outside. So it was in an ashram near Tokyo. I visited him. I said, I want to sit in that glass cave that he made, a glass cave, and the breathing oxygen was poured in with the least amount of sound, so it shouldn't bother you. When you sit in that, you can hear your heartbeat, whether you have any palpitation or not. You can hear your breathing so clearly. All the sound that you don't normally hear, you start hearing in the chamber. So I said, there's so many sound within, and there's so much gurgling in the belly, which we don't bother about. Sit in the glass chamber, you'll hear it. There is so much happening in the body, those sounds come. When you try to concentrate your attention behind the eyes, even the flow of blood on the side can be heard. So there are so many sounds which are physical in nature, and they resemble many outside sounds. And when you hear them, you say, there's no pull in these sounds. There is no pull in those sounds, they are physical sounds. There's nothing coming from you. Some people say, we want to hear on the right side or the left side. Left is negative, right is positive. When did left and right become positive? Ever since they discovered that the brain has an intuitive side and a rational side. So left and right became, stay on the right side. I met a yogi who wanted to practice Surta Shabda Yoga. For 15 years he was practicing listening to the right side. I said, you will never find yourself. You are not in the ear. You are not on the right side at all. You are in the center. Why are you trying to concentrate on the right side? Somebody told me that the real, that's the positive side, that's the negative side. If you are still going to be negative and positive, yes, hear the sounds at the right or the left side. But if you want to hear your sound that pulls, it's right in the center. It looks like it's in the center where you are. And as you rise, it looks like coming from above and below and around you. And that pulls you. What happens when it pulls you? It makes you feel you are being pulled off, swept off your feet. That's the kind of experience. When it pulls you, it's the fastest way, if you put attention on that, it's the fastest way to get unaware of the body, which they call vacating the body. You become unaware of the body rapidly. With other means, by repeating words, mantra, and so on, and trying to concentrate, which is the longer method, you are taking a long time to push yourself into that. This is a pull, not a push. So when you're pulled, it's much easier to get vacated. When you get vacated from the body, you feel free. You forget that you are in the head. You forget you are in a new open space. You are a new sky you see outside. It's a whole new world has opened up. And the beauty of that is that you suddenly find there's no darkness there. The sky is never black or dark like this one. 24/7, anytime you're there, it's not a very bright light. It's a twilight, it's a subdued grayish light in that atmosphere. You can see everything with no external light. It appears that everything is generating its own light to be seen. That's a very big difference from the experience we have in the physical plane. And then you find you can fly. There's no gravity. You have no physical material body. And yet your sense perceptions are intact. That's what makes that experience so beautiful. You can fly wherever you like. You're still you're connected with this world still. Because that stage, which we call the astral experience, or the astral stage, has two large parts. A small part of it overlaps the physical part. So you still feel you are here. And you see people, they can't see you. You can walk around just like you would be dead. You are moving in that part of yourself which you would be moving after you really physically die. You get into that state. It is like dying while living. You die while living and you move around. And that's a great thing. But if you are initiated by a perfect living master, and I said perfect living master is one whose awareness is right up to totality, so he knows you better than you know yourself. If such a person is in your life, he will appear after you fly some small distances into that space. Have experience of journeying, and then you meet, and that's all part of the astral experience. It's all happening inside your head right there. Looks like you have left the body. Body is alive. Body's heartbeat is the same. There used to be a lady in the Dera where great master, my master, used to teach, who was a great meditator. And she had really reached several levels of experiences. Sometimes she was permitted by the great master to tell us about them. And she would go into those levels, and there was a doctor, a lady doctor, Dr. Shakuntala. She lived in a town about 15, 20 miles away called Kapurthala. And that lady loved great master. He said, "You are a beautiful man. I like your beard. I like your face, radiant face. But I don't believe what you tell us. I don't believe there is any such thing. I am a medical doctor. I have had my own training in believing how the body works. I know everything about the body. And I don't believe in any of this stuff." One day, that lady who used to meditate so much, she did not come out of her little hut, which her little hut was next to our house where we lived in the Dera. And people came and said, "The lady did not come out, maybe she died inside, so let's break the door." And they broke the door, and they found the lady in meditation. Now, when she had walked into the room, there was a piece of jaggery, we call gur or jaggery, lying on the floor, and she stepped on that and then sat in meditation, little realizing that sugar was on her feet. Some ants were crawling and they began to eat up her heel. She was in such a bad state physically that ants are eating her feet and she's lying with no signs of life. We got worried, so we called Great Master, whose house was nearby, and he came, and he says, he looked at that Bibi, that lady. He said, "Call Dr. Shakuntala." So Dr. Shakuntala's car was sent and she came. And the great master said, "Doctor, examine this patient. She's so unconscious about herself that these ants have crawled and eating up her heel and she doesn't know." Doctor said, "She is in a deep coma. And this is a very bad case. You remove her to a bigger hospital straight away." Great master said, "You know, she is roaming around in the higher regions." And doctor said, "Please, no time for jokes. She is going to die. She is in deep coma. You are talking of higher regions at this time." He said, "No, we can ask her. She will tell us. How can she talk? She is totally unconscious." He said, "When you are totally unconscious in a deep coma like you are talking of, doctor, do the reflexes of the body also disappear?" "Yes, in this kind of deep coma they do." "Doctor, can you check them?" He took a little hammer of his and began to hit here and there. And he said, "No, the reflexes are normal. What about the heartbeat? Does it get affected in deep coma?" "It slows down. And will you check it? No, the heart seems to be all right. Breathing is all right. Vital signs are all right. Then what is happening, doctor? Such a case has never come into my practice. I think you should remove this patient immediately before she dies. Great Master said, she is roaming around. I'll just ask her. He said, baby, wake up. And the baby opened her eyes. What were you doing? Oh, thank you very much, Master. She put her hands like this and said, I was really having a great ride in Kan Brahmand. I was going to the causal region. I was examining these things. Doctor was surprised and became a disciple of Great Master after that. So these are great experiences we have seen with our own eyes, such things happening. The same lady, one time, because we were her neighbors, one time was screaming in her little hut. And we all got alarmed. What is happening? Because she was a very respected woman because she meditated. She could talk of internal experiences. She was really enlightened. So she was screaming inside. And the door was locked from inside. So again, we had to call the great master and break open the door to get in. She was still screaming. So great master said, why are you screaming? She said, I am in hell. What kind of hell? Oh, I am in that deep hell you once described, and that deep hell, they are torturing people. I can see people being burnt. I can see people being tortured in a way I can't imagine. That's why I can't stop crying and screaming. He said, are they hurting you? No, they are not hurting me. Then why are you crying? I can't even stand what they are doing to others. He says, repeat the 5 holy words I gave you and come out. I've forgotten those 5 words. It's so bad here. He said, can you hear my voice? Now we are watching all this show going on. Can you hear my voice? Yes, I can. Okay, then come out, follow my voice. And she opened her eyes and touched his feet. He said, you see, unguided, without master, don't explore that part of the astral plane where these hells and heavens lie. They are traps. So don't think the whole journey can be all wonderful and pleasant. These unpleasant experiences are also built into the same area of experience. That is why I always advise my friends, if you want to go deep into meditation, be pulled by the Shabad to those levels, be guided by a master, be initiated by a master. Let him be there. You can travel anywhere you like in the company of your master who knows the route, who knows what is good and what is bad. So don't do it alone. Don't try all these tricks of meditation. I am trying to find out myself. You can go into very difficult situations. Well, thank you very much for your attention. I will have a break for lunch now, and I'll see you again at 3 o'clock.